Welcome back to the Learn WGPU series. Today we're going to talk about instancing. Instancing is a technique that allows us to draw one object many times. So instead of giving all of the data for all of the objects in, say, like a 100 by 100 or 10,000 by 10,000 grid, instead what we can do is we can instruct the GPU to basically render copies of the same data so that we don't have to spend a ton of time throwing all of that data back and forth over the wire. As a reminder, we are starting out with this textured pentagon with an image of a tree on it. So the scene is very simple right now. It is just that textured pentagon. We have one object centered at 000, but what if we want more? This is where instancing comes in. Instancing allows us to draw the same object multiple times with different properties, such as position, orientation, size, color, etc. While there are multiple ways of doing instancing, we're going to use a way for performance reasons, because we don't want to be recreating all of our buffers all the time for this instance data. If we look at the drawIndexed function, which is the function that we are currently using to draw on line 431 right here, we can see that there is an instances argument that takes a range, similar to the way that other fields like indices take a range. That range parameter tells the GPU how many copies or instances of the model that we want to draw. Currently for instances, we're drawing 0 to 1, which is only one model, the number 0, because remember, ranges are exclusive by default. So this is just 0. If we increase this number to something like 5, we would get 5 instances. The fact that instances is a range may seem weird, as using 1.2 for instances would still draw one instance of the object. But we don't use a U32, because if we use a range, then we can specify different ranges of the objects to render at a given time. And again, similar to the way that everything else works, we're going to create an instance buffer in addition to, you know, the vertex buffer, the index buffer, etc., etc. Now I'm going to start out adding this code right at the top of our file. So struct instance with two fields, position and rotation, that both use CG math fields or types. One is a vector 3 of F32s, so a vec 3 F32, and one is a quaternion made of F32s. The tutorial goes on to say a quaternion is a mathematical structure used to represent rotation, but they're not going to explain it. The TLDR that I'll give you is a quaternion is a four-dimensional number, like a four-dimensional imaginary number. That won't mean a lot to you unless you already know what imaginary numbers are in higher dimensions, but that's what it is. The tutorial goes on to say that quaternions don't have a WGSL analog, which is true. There is no like quaternion type that we can use in WGSL. So we do have to convert the instance with the position and the rotation to something else that we then presumably pass to the GPU. In this case, we're going to turn it into a matrix called instance raw. And we're going to call this matrix the model matrix. We've covered bitemux pod and bitemux zeroable in previous lessons. So go back to the vertex buffer. I believe that's the right lesson if you want to learn more about bitemux. So if you look at this and you're not familiar with linear algebra, you may be confused as to why we're using a matrix here. And basically, because the rotation can be represented as a linear transformation, and the position or a translation can be represented as, so for example, if we have a three-dimensional translation, if we take that to four dimensions, we perform a shear, which is a linear transformation, and then we flatten that back down into three dimensions, effectively what we've got is a translation. So given that knowledge, we can turn both of those linear transformations into one combined model matrix. And I assume that's what we're going to do here. So the values that we're using here and the values that we're using here are actually the same thing. They mean the same thing. But in our Rust code, we're going to be able to work with a vec3, which is nice to work with, and a quaternion, which is also nicer to work with than dealing with a 4x4 matrix in our Rust code. And then we're going to translate this into that matrix. And then when we multiply this matrix by some vector, it will translate it by this model space transform. We impl on instance specifically to be able to take it from an instance to the instance raw. So we have this toRaw function on instance that returns an instance raw, and the instance raw is just a straightforward CG math matrix 4 from translation self.position. Now, if we continue going down that really long line, we can see that this is also multiplied by the rotation. So like I said before, we have a four-dimensional matrix a position or a translation in three dimensions can be represented as a shear in four dimensions, which is a linear transformation. If we multiply that by the rotation matrix, then what we are doing is basically rotating and then moving. So we can combine any two values into two matrices into a single matrix by multiplying, and then we can use those numbers to actually do the multiplication on the actual values that we want to render. We need to go back into our very well-kept and definitely not absolutely gigantic state struct and add two more fields to it. In this case, we're adding instances and instance buffer. The instances is a vec of instances, and the instance buffer is a WGPU buffer, which we've used a number of times before. The CG math library uses traits to provide some really handy helper functions on vec3s and quaternions, for example. So we're going to bring those traits in using the CG math prelude. That's this on line 10. Now, right at the top here, we're going to drop in some instances. We're going to do basically like an N by N grid of these models, right? An N by N grid of these trees and pentagons. So we define the number of instances per row in that grid, and then we define instance displacement. I think that this is better visualized as a vec3 with new lines in it, so I've changed that, but I haven't changed the functionality. This is the same functionality as is in the tutorial. So we've got a vec3 here, or a vector3 from CG math, and the x value is the number of instances per row times 0.5, then 0 on the y-axis, and in the z-axis, number of instances per row times 0.5. And that gives us a vec3 for how far to displace each of the instances in this grid. Again, back down in our new function, so that's the new function on impulse state, it's telling us to do some instance generation. We so far don't seem to need any of the other things that we've needed in the past, things like the device, for example. This is just going to be, it seems like, data. So let me minimize that browser for a second here, and let's talk about what we're doing for the instances. So our instances are a range from 0 to num instances per row, and we're going to flat map over that, which means we're going to map over it and create another vec inside of it and then flatten that as well. And then we do 0 dot dot num instances per row. I feel like this could be named better because this is going to be a num instances per row by num instances per row grid. So that's why we're getting the z value here, which is the index, so we would be at 0, and then the x value here, so 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 3, etc. The function that I usually use here instead is called Cartesian product and comes from iterTools, and I find that that is a little bit more readable. So we map over all of that. So we've got an x for every z. We let the position for the given instance that we're working with be x, y of 0, and then z. So these are all just exactly the index that we're getting. And then we subtract the instance displacement. We do a little special casing for the quaternion of 0. So if position.is 0, which would mean that x is 0, y is 0, and z is 0, then we create a special quaternion with the unit z. So I'm assuming that's 0, 0, 1 with a rotation of 0. Otherwise, we create a quaternion from the axis angle. We take the position and we normalize it. So if we have, like, I don't know, 5, 6, 10 or something like that. Those are horrible numbers to mentally do math with. But basically, normalize takes it down to a unit vector, if you remember that. So every position, every point, so an XYZ point, can be thought of as a vector, a position or a vector from 0 to that point. So what this normalize function is doing is making the length of that vector 1, which will change the X, Y, and Z position. Well, we'll most likely change the X, Y, and Z positions anyway. It doesn't have to. And then we use the degrees of 45 to set that rotation. And then we return an instance. So we do that for every point in the grid. The instance data is then turned into the instance raw. This is just iterating over. I wonder if we're going to use this later, because I feel like that could have been done right here. And then we create our instance buffer, which does need the device. So it does need to be further down in our new function than the place that we create the device. And we create our buffer with the buffer init descriptor. We've seen this descriptor pattern for buffers before, so I'll assume you've gone through the other videos in this playlist. If you haven't, they're probably in the description or on the right. We label it. The contents are the instance data, and we use this data in the vertex shader. Now, we didn't talk about it earlier, but this cast slice on this instance data works because all the way at the top, when we create instance raw, we do repr c, which is the in-memory representation that C uses for this struct, which means that we get to just throw it in as slice. But we are not done yet. But oh no, we are not done yet. Let's go back up to instance raw because we are going to write more code up here. And on instance raw, so impl instance raw, which is different than impl instance, which we did before, we're going to create a function called desc, which means description. Now description uses a generic, or all lifetimes are technically generic, so it just uses a lifetime. And we return a WGPU vertex buffer layout that uses that lifetime. Inside of this function, for some reason, we use standard mem. I don't know why this needs to be inside of this function. I don't think it does. I think it can be up top if we want it to be. But we return a vertex buffer layout. So this is the structure of the buffer that we are going to use to pack this instance data into so that when we send it to the vertex shader, this is how it gets it. So when we create this vertex buffer layout, if we look at the WGPU docs alongside this struct that we're creating, the array stride is basically going to be how many bytes we need to skip to get to the next instance, or in this case, instance raw. So this array stride is going to be the memory size of an instance raw. And this is a buffer address, so we treat it as a buffer address. The step mode is how often this vertex buffer is, quote, stepped forward. There are two options. The default is vertex, so we're stepping for each vertex. The secondary option, the one that we're using here, is stepping per instance. Inside of the attributes, we do set up a vertex attribute. This offset is at zero, and it makes a note here that while the vertex shader, so if we go to the vertex shader, we're only using vertex input location zero and location one here. And that's what this is saying. We're using location zero and location one now, but the tutorial wants to reserve 2, 3, and 4 for sort of later. So we're starting arbitrarily at 5 here. So instead of having location 0 and location 1, we're going to have location 0, location 1, and location 5. Which seems like a weird choice, but that's what it is. The format of this attribute is going to be a vec for F32. Now, I think all of these attributes combine into being the matrix. So we've got a vec 4 for each of the rows in the matrix. I think actually, I'm not sure if it's row or column based. But suffice it to say, you can think of it as either 4 rows or 4 columns right now. It doesn't really matter. We still need 4 of them either way because it's a 4x4 matrix. So basically we're breaking this apart into 4 vecs. So a vec for F32, 4 times. And that gives us four vecs. So a 4x4 matrix if we put it back together, which we'll have to reassemble this back in the shader. So this vertex buffer layout descriptor is going to have to get used in the render pipeline. So if we go find our render pipeline descriptor, for me right now, it's on line 370. And we go look at our buffers here. We've already got the vertex description. So the only other one we need is the instance raw description. I'll put this back into something that's a little bit similar to the formatting we had before. So the buffers in this case have the vertex buffer description or the vertex buffer layout first, and then the instance raw description second. And of course, because we haven't done it yet, we do have to add instances and the instance buffer that we created in the new function, even though we just jumped around a little bit. We did create those in the new function earlier, so we do have to add them to the state returned value. So we've got this extra buffer that we're passing in, and the extra buffer is going to be at index 1, like we just set up with our buffer layout descriptors. So we're going to add a vertex buffer with the instance buffer data. We're taking a reference to it by taking a slice, and we're setting that in the one position. Now we also have to update draw index. So we've got 0.numindices 0 and 0.1. Instead, we're going to have 0.numindices 0. And then the only thing that changes here is instead of having 0 to 1, we have 0 to the number of instances that we have. I'm not sure why this is as underscore. I think it's trying to get this to do like inference on what this type should be. So we'll see what that does in a second. There's a big red box here that says, make sure if you add new instances to the vec that you recreate the instance buffer as well as the camera bind group. Otherwise your new instances won't show up correctly. So at this point, I think our rest code is done and we get to go into our shader. So right above vertex input, I'm going to set up the instance input, which is going to be our 4x4 matrix, or each of the parts of our 4x4 matrix. So we do in our vertex main, or our vertex entry point, we have to grab instance. And then I assume that this happens above everything else. They don't show any of the other code, so I can't be sure. We have the model matrix here, which we've constructed a 4x4 matrix out of the F32 values by using each of our 0, 1, 2, and 3 VEC4s as the 4x4 matrix. The only thing that changes in this next snippet is the clip position. So the clip position is now, instead of just the view projection times the model position, it's the view projection times the model matrix times the model position. So let's say we've got a vertex at XYZ. We want to move that according to our model matrix, according to our rotation. We want to apply the transformation that is encapsulated in our matrix, that is either a translation and a rotation, or any combination of the two, before we put it into view space, because the model matrix is a world space transformation. It is not a view space transformation. So if we do that correctly, then what we get here is a bunch of pentagons set up in a large grid, rotated at specific angles. All of them should be rotated at slightly different ways and placed in slightly different positions. And they are all effectively the same geometry. I feel like they changed their own viewport, because this is not exactly what we got out of the result here, which is totally fine. We still got all of the important pieces here. It's just that their camera position is in a different place than our camera position. But we do have that grid of the trees, which is wonderful. And we still have, I believe, some of our controls from when we did the camera stuff. So we can take a look at these. And if we do zoom out to something that looks a little bit more like what we had in the tutorial image, you can see how the rotations are affecting this. So with these side by side, you can see that we are getting pretty much what we expected to get. Now, I won't be able to line up my camera exactly the same way because I don't know where their camera is. So it is what it is. It looks similar enough to me. So that's instancing. Now, one of the things I'm really curious about actually is what happens if we just crank this number up and then we run it and then we click and we zoom out to a whole gosh darn forest. Wow, that is quite a few of them. And now because these are two-dimensional objects, some of them are starting to not appear if we rotate the camera in the right direction, because they're planes and they line up with the camera basically. Or if we look at the back side of them, we aren't rendering the back side or the back faces of this geometry. So we can get quite a few of these here. I think our camera is rotating a bit when I zoom out like that, or maybe it's actually hitting the frustum. That might be the other thing. We might just have too many trees. there might be so many trees here that they are completely filling our camera space. So you can obviously create a ton of instances of some given thing with less performance impact than it would take if you actually were to copy all of that data and send it back over. So I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you enjoyed the next episode of Learn WGPU. I think we only have one or two left before we get to intermediate. So this is almost the end of the beginner series. So we've got the depth buffer next and then model loading. And then that'll be the end of the Learn WGPU series. I guess we could do the intermediate. I'll take a look at those, see if those make sense to do. If you want those, let me know in the description so that I know to make the videos. And I will see you in the next one. Have a great day.